Hello everyone, welcome to another time-lapse tutorial. This time-lapse video is created from the full-length videos that I have made for my patrons. So if you are a patron, you can watch those videos that I have posted on my Patreon page a few weeks ago. And speaking of patron, let me give a shout out to the new patrons who have joined me in December 2019. We have Richard Kerr, Maduri, Cindy, Crystal Wyman, Catherine Kevison, Jacqueline Satterley, Chris Leong, Susan DeCorsi, Jasmine Elgersmar, Stephen Choi, Elaine Diane Dos Santos. Thank you all very much for joining me on Patreon. Patreon is one of the reasons why you do not see sponsored ads on my YouTube channels. My videos are not brought to you by any companies. My videos are brought to you by you for supporting me and for watching my videos. And this is one of the reasons why I am able to create such a huge variety of videos on my YouTube channel. Alright, for today's tutorial, we will be sketching this boathouse. This is a photo that I have taken in Amsterdam a few months ago during the Urban Sketchers Symposium. You can download this reference photo from the video description below. And what you're looking at right now is me measuring the proportion of the boathouse, measuring the angles that I see using my mechanical pencil. I would consider this to be a challenging sketch because of the curves, because of the dynamic lines created by the perspective. So for challenging sketches like this, I tend to start with pencils to lay out the elements first, make sure that I am able to fit the drawing onto the page, and also to make sure that I will not leave out any important things. And getting the curves right for this particular sketch, it's important because you want to convey a sense of perspective. So using a pencil is a very easy way to make it easier for you to sketch. So here I'm just drafting in the layout, drawing the big shapes. For the details, I will be adding those with my pen and ink. So I start by drawing the tree because the tree overlaps some of the elements behind. And if you take a look at the reference photo, you can see a lot of details in the background. Those details will be drawn with thinner lines because they are further away. Things are smaller when they are further away, so they will be drawn with thinner lines. For the lines that are in front, that are close to us, I will draw them with thicker lines. And I just drew the angled line that represents the edge. And just to the right side of the edge, we have the boat. So now this is where all the pencil lines really help me. I can just follow the pencil lines to draw the boat. Now this boat is in perspective and there is a lot of foreshortening and curves that are foreshortened. Sometimes they can be quite tricky. So using a pencil really makes it so much easier for me to draw. And while I am drawing, if I notice anything off with my pencils, I can just correct it with pen. So for this particular boathouse, you can see there isn't a lot of details right in front, or maybe this is the back of the boathouse. I actually don't know which side is the front. Anyway, there is not a lot of details for the area that is closer to me. But for the backgrounds, we have all the buildings, the trees, the little elements. So this is a nice contrast. We have areas with a lot of details and areas without a lot of details. So when you're drawing, it's good to have areas of contrast. It can be contrast of colors, contrast of details, contrast that's provided by curves versus straight lines. And when you have contrast, when you have things that are different, it makes your sketch look more interesting. So for this particular part, I'm drawing the top of the boat. Now this reference photo, well, sometimes it can be quite tricky to draw from reference photos because cameras, sometimes they don't capture details that are in the shadow well. And also for overlapping elements, sometimes it's a bit difficult to see how they overlap from the photo. If you're drawing on location, it's very easy because your eyes can sense the depth, the foreground and background elements very easily. So for this part now, I'm drawing the buildings in the background with very thin lines. And to do so, I actually turned my fountain pen, the fountain pen nib on the opposite side so that the lines can be thinner. So for these buildings, I started by drawing the big shapes first and then filling the little details within those shapes, such as the windows. And this applies, strategy of drawing big shapes and then filling in the details is, I think, one of the fundamentals for drawing. Because once you get the big shapes right, you will be able to place the elements within those shapes more easily. Okay, so for the foreground on the left side, I'm adding a lot more details now, adding more elements to portray the foreground and background. Now, if you have problems measuring the angles, you can use your pen, stretch out your arm, lock your elbows, and use your pen and place your pen at an angle to the angle that you see in real life. And think of the clock face, think of the minute hand. So if the angle is 45 degrees, the minute hand may be showing about 4:30 p.m. So just remember that angle, and when you draw on your paper, just remember that angle. This is a good tip for drawing angles, because sometimes when you're drawing, you may look at the angle and think to yourself, oh, okay, this angle is about this angle. But when you actually draw on the page, it is something else. You draw the angle a bit off. So when you think of the minute hand on the clock face, there is no way you can get the angle wrong, because at 4:30 p.m., for example, the minute hand will be exactly 45 degrees. So your brain may be telling you to draw maybe the angle at a more gentle angle, but you know for a fact, because you have measured angle, you know that it's exactly 45 degrees, the minute hand is at 4:30, you can just draw it based on what you see, not what you think you see. So for the watercolor section, I am using a limited color palette just to keep it simple. When you paint with a limited color palette, you don't have to worry too much about color mixing, because you only have three colors. For example, if you are just using yellow, red, and blue, and to mix greens, you only have two options, which is to use yellow and blue. And if you want different variations of green, you can just add the opposite color, the complementary color, which is red, to get different shades of green. So it's very easy to mix colors with a limited color palette. The challenge to using a limited color palette is actually to create the contrast that you see. So you don't have to worry too much about color mixing, you just have to worry about getting the contrast right. And for this particular scene, there are strong contrast areas, such as below the boat on the water. Those areas are really dark, like close to black. So when I painted the bottom of the boat the first time round, it was dark, but when it dried, the watercolor dried lighter, so I had to go in a second time to make it even darker. So when painting this sketch, I'm constantly comparing what I have on the paper to what I see in the photo. If it doesn't look dark enough, I have to go in and make it darker. And to make the shadow areas darker, with this limited color palette, it's just adding more blue to it. Now the colors that you have in your limited color palette is actually quite important, because certain colors, they have low tinting strength. And for this particular scene, it's not I probably would not recommend using colors that have low tinting strength, for example, cerulean blue. If you have cerulean blue, you won't be able to mix really dark shadows. So sometimes you do need to know the characteristics of the colors that you use. But of course, it really depends on the style that you are going after. So now that I have painted everything, I'm just using the white gel pen to add details. For the windows on the buildings in the background, I'm just drawing the rectangular frames, and I'm adding some white gouache to the windows to give it more contrast. So for the lines, I really enjoy drawing the lines from the power poles or the power cables. These lines, I think they make the scene look more lively, and it provides a good contrast. Again, earlier on I mentioned when you have lines that are straight and lines that are curved, it gives you good contrast. It makes the scene more interesting. Alright, so this is the completed sketch. If you want to learn more about sketching, you can check out my Patreon or Gumroad pages, or check out the many free tutorials that I have on my YouTube playlist. All the links are in the video description below. Okay, thanks for watching. See you guys in the next video. Bye!